It's interesting because I think that I was having this conversation with a friend of mine the other day, and we don't, like, actors, the only time we talk about genre really is when we're promoting a film or when we're talking about journalists, because I don't think it's something that really factors into, well, certainly it doesn't to my thought process when I'm picking a role. You know, it's, you're not thinking like, oh, I want to do a romantic comedy, only show me romantic comedies from now on. You know, you don't say that to your agents because you just go, you're just looking for a good film, you're looking for good scripts. And when this script came along, like, I'd read a few romantic comedies around that time. Some of them actually were really, really good, but this one just sort of stood out to me, and also, pardon me, at the time, had kind of the realest chance of going, so I definitely, like, I really wanted to be a part of it.
And what was it about this movie in particular that caught your
eye? Well, just the fact that it was very, very smart. The dialogue seemed, you know, it was both funny, but it was also the kind of, you know, it didn't feel like contrived funny. It felt like how people actually speak, which is great. And just the you know, it I found it very kind of moving at the end of the film as well, like, without trying too hard. It is just a very simple, sweet story that is, I think, quite emotionally affecting as well. Not in a big way at all, but just, you know, it, films like this can often be kind of disposable and can be very entertaining to watch for a bit, and then you sort of forget about them immediately. But I hope that this is the kind of film that will sort of stick with people for longer than the 90 minutes or whatever that it runs for. I absolutely initially learnt the part American, but then, to be honest, what happened was that I got out there, yeah, or Canadian, indeed, North American. What happened when I got out there was, like, a day, 2 days before we started filming, I was in Canada. The production company said, like, you have to do it English. And I was like, why? I've learnt it American. You've, like, we've had many discussions about the accent for the last month. And it, I think it was that they were like, you're not marketable in an American, not in your own accent, basically in an accent that people don't recognize you as, which is, like, bad news for Horns and all the other stuff that I've done in American accents. But you know, it was just, it was kind of one of those ridiculous last minute panics on their behalf. And I certainly wasn't going to suddenly go, well, screw you guys, I'm going to put, you know, 200 people out of work for the sake of an accent. So okay. I wasn't obviously going to do that. So that's why I'm English in the film. It wasn't through a choice. but yeah, it was, it ended up being really good. Like, it ended up being fine for the character. It's his, you know, there isn't anything about the character in the script that is inherently American or Canadian. So it didn't, like, change the story at all. It was just a little annoying. Cause I like doing American accents. It's fun. Yeah, so it was like, but no, sorry, I'm trying to think of other things about the script originally. No, you're saying about the speech patterns. Yeah, I think that evolved as well, just because we used a lot of improvisation during the film. So I think a lot of my own personality and stuff does sort of come out through the character. And obviously, you know, I talk quite fast, so he talks quite fast. There isn't any process to choosing a script beyond reading it and really enjoying it or not enjoying it for me. You know, I think I'm very lucky in the sense that I've got good instinct, and both my parents were sort of, you know, everything they worked on when they could choose or had some say in what they worked on. You know, my mum was a casting director, and most of what she did was working for Peter Kosminski, like, he does kind of a lot of very intense political stuff on TV and challenging things. And my dad, you know, my dad's whole job as a literary agent was to find new writers and playwrights. So I like to think that I've inherited some of their kind of tastes and instincts for scripts. But I just like things that, good dialogue and, you know, fully realized characters, and you know, if it's kind of original or has some sort of fresh take on something, then that's great too.
Have you ever had real stinkers come across your desk?
Oh God, yes, absolutely. Like, I mean, I'm yet to read. I mean, there's been a couple of kind of good action films. But, I mean, the action film, people think the romantic comedy genre, because it's been interesting the last sort of month or so of talking about the rom-com, it's interesting to me, people are much more, people think of it as really being a genre that's kind of had a bad time recently, and I get that, but I don't think it's as bad as the action movie things are, just because, like, no one cares about, like, there is never, like, a character involved in any of those films. It's just the same people sort of thrown in different cities with different cars. Like, it's really, and I like, you know, action movies, and I feel like there used to be lots of really witty ones, like, you know, Die Hard and Lethal Weapon, those kind of films, and but even like The Bourne Identity are kind of, I suppose, the great action movies of our time, but it's I don't know, they're few and far between when you find, like, a really good one. Expendables. I knew you were going to say that. Well, they got everyone else. I mean, they might as well. Action movies. Right. No. I've been reading. Yeah, I've read a few of them. I can't really picture myself in an action movie type of role. That's why I think I have trouble reading them. I think one of the things you should do as an actor is know what you're not right for as well as what you are. And, you know, I actually, and that's the thing, I get kind of an unusual amount of action in the other stuff I do. Like Frankenstein's got loads, Harry Potter obviously had loads, but Horns also had quite a bit. So, you know, I get my fill of it as well without having to actually do like the rest of the terrible action movie around it. What was the first part of your question again? Sorry. Oh, yeah, that's got to screen. There have been, I won't say what they were, but nothing, I would tell you if I was genuinely disappointed. Like, there was nothing so far that I'd been like, damn it, I should have done that. Like, so far everything I've said no to has, you know, I've never been left gutted. You know, but it'll happen one day. It's bound to. Like, I'm sure everyone has stories like that, so... I could see, this is the thing, this is like the cycle of a press tour in one, like in 5 minutes. I say something and I'm already being asked about it in a way that I find disconcerting, like it's being made into something more than it should have been. No, I mean, I just think that there's like, there is, obviously there's so many effects laden things that it's very easy to throw like massive, incredibly impressive effects at things. But ultimately what makes, if you think of all the action movies, like, that have been, you know, like all the action movies to me that I love, like Die Hard and The Matrix, are movies that have amazing stories and amazing characters at the center of them, characters who you are kind of rooting for and thrilled by, like, all the time. And, you know, I think sometimes you get action films can have very homogenized kind of stories and type kind of archetypal characters.
He doesn't want the bad. You don't want the bad. You don't want all action movies to stop.
No. Exactly. Yeah. Bad action movies should still be made.
All
right. My theory is that, you know, if the first half of something is truly terrible, then the second half of it can never be good enough to warrant the first half, if you know what I mean. Like, no matter how good the twist is at the end or whatever, like, you can never agree with making somebody sit through the first crappy half of a movie. So I guess, like, if I'm not, like, loving it by halfway through, then that's, after that, it can be the point where I go, okay, I can pass on this. But, like, I generally do, like, I try and finish everything, just because, you know, if you're meeting directors or anything, it helps to have read the whole thing. But I have, you know, I've had friends who've gone in for stuff and, like, have done that thing of only having read their bits. Doesn't go down well. But yeah, I mean, there have definitely been, I'm sure there have been moments where I've just gone, oh, no, this is not going to be good.
Any memorable first line?
Not really. I'm sorry. I wish I had a really funny one for you now, but I don't think I do. But there was definitely... I tell you, the worst idea that ever came across us was... It was way before Potter had finished, and it was for somebody suggesting that they remake the Wizard of Oz movies, or the Wizard of Oz movie, with Emma as Dorothy, and then me and Rupert cast... I don't know, various things. I was the lion, and Rupert was either Tin Man or Scarecrow. I don't know which. You can write whichever's funnier. It was... I remember getting that and just being like, that person is the laziest crazy person in the world. Like, that's the... Yeah, it's... So that was quite funny. But other than that, nothing.
We all want to see that, don't we?
I'm sure you do. I mean, I've obviously not been somebody that, like, shirks nudity throughout my career, so no, that was definitely me. And yeah, as far as nude scenes go, that was, like, it. You know, my previous nude scenes have generally been about, like, losing your virginity or blinding horses, so this was, like, as they go, this was, like, a really nice one. But no, I don't think it's changed my views on romance particularly. I think I was mildly romantic before, and I think I'm probably the same amount now. Like, you know, I don't think I've done sort of vaguely romantic gestures and big things like that, but not, I don't know, I don't think that's what a relationship relies upon. I mean, I think just learning lines from a young age and kind of getting used to the process of learning them is sort of what gets you used to that. I also do the musical I did on on Broadway was called How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying, and it was by the guys that wrote Guys and Dolls, so it was all that kind of similar, very fast-paced sort of stuff, and that was in an American accent, by the way, and the show did fine. I think that, like, I enjoy the fast talking stuff, and, like, I always like kind of Neil Simon plays when I was young, or films, and so I love all that, but I think a lot of it's just me, like, that's my natural pace of, which is not, I'm not saying that, like, oh, it's great, I'm so quick thinking, it's because I'm not quick thinking, I'm, like, slow thinking and fast talking, which is a terrible combination, I think it's probably just more me than anything else.
So does that mean you say things and you regret them as you're saying them?
Or? Like, what's the last month of my life been? I don't think I've ever used a chat up line on a girl. Like, I had a list of chat up lines thrown at me earlier, and I was just saying, should I be using these? Because they sound terrible. Like, these, I definitely haven't. What, I'm trying to think if I had anything used on me. I have had a couple of, like, fairly cheesy Harry Potter lines done to me, but I've always just been quite impressed by, like, it takes some balls to walk up and say some of the things I've had said to me. I genuinely can't remember off the top of my head what they were, but I just remember being kind of impressed. Sorry, what was the first part of your question? Fridge magnets. Not so much over fridge magnets. I'm sure I've had, like, my versions of meet cutes before, but not, we haven't done that yet. Fridge magnets, I found, tend to descend just very quickly into, like, how can you write the filthiest thing with the cleanest words? So that's the game we ended up playing on set, I think. We had, like, 4 days rehearsal before we started shooting, and Zoe and I had met once years before, but not for very long, and yeah, I mean, we kind of knew enough of each other in that first meeting, I think, to know we'd enjoy making the film together when we came up for the parts, but yeah, I mean, I think a lot of the chemistry thing is just being, you know, being interested and being open and being kind of generous and not, like, not worrying about... That's the thing, a lot of between takes and stuff is just telling each other, like, embarrassing stories from youth and, you know, from terrible exes or dates or whatever it is, and just swapping that stuff, so you sort of, you try and match the kind of collective memory that your characters have together as well, and the thing and their shared knowledge of each other, so that you can, you know, have that relationship on screen and kind of and use that stuff. And there's stuff that didn't end up in the movie. There's, like, one thing I'm incredibly grateful didn't end up in the movie, which is me telling, like, one of the most embarrassing stories of my childhood, which is great, because I will be able to, you know, improvise it and use it in another movie, because it's really funny. But it's definitely. You know, it's those moments that kind of, I think, help contribute to that chemistry, and that takes two people. Like, if just me was turning up with that attitude, it would be a very frustrating 6 weeks, I imagine, on the film. But thankfully, Zoe and I both came with that sort of same spirit. I was perfectly happy with the way everything ended. I thought she did a fine job. If anything, I felt like Harry and Hermione would have been a bit of a sort of predictable way to go, if anything. It definitely wasn't something that I thought needed changing. But, you know, it's her character, so she's entitled to change her mind. In terms of Wallace and Chantry, it's very hard. You know, that's what's lovely about the film. It's always, you know, it's very hard to show or explain why it is that two people connect in the way they do and fall in love the way they do. But, you know, in this movie, that's what it's about. It's sort of about watching them and finding out why they love each other with them. I mean, they have very similar sense of humours there. But that's also what I love about it, is that it, you know, in a normal movie, it would be much less of a dilemma, because Zoe's in sort of your normal rom-com, there's me, the girl I fancy, and then the girl I fancy's boyfriend, who is a tool normally, and it's just horrible, and you kind of are just going, why is she with him? That makes no sense. And it's kind of inevitable that she will end up with the nice guy rather than the horrible guy. And it just makes it a much more, as you say, sort of like the whole thing about the film was you're trying to be truer to life and more authentic, and it makes it a much more real situation. You know, she's not... choosing between a bad guy and a good guy. She's got a great relationship. She just happens to be falling in love with somebody else. And that seems a lot more realer and a lot more, you know, to create a bit more dramatic tension. Yes, I mean, like, that's the thing. Like, something really crappy happens to him in this movie, and not something that he provokes or in any way, you know, deserves, really. And we say that, but I think that's if there's a point to be made about the film, and there's not really, but you know, if there is, it's that, you know, it's about it's about how silly it is to live in denial of your own feelings, and B, it's you know, love is complicated and not clean and easy a lot of the time, and but that doesn't make it less valid or less true in terms of your feelings for somebody. I mean, yes, obviously, yes, they can. but I'm sure plenty of you have friends of the opposite gender, and you have not slept with all of them. So there, we have the proof.
What are you implying?
Well, I mean, I'm not. Well, that's the thing. It's like, there's been an interesting, like, the question that everyone else has asked about this film and that everyone else has thought this film is asking is the same one as Harry Met Sally, like, can men and women really be friends? Like, the truth of the film is it ever sensible or sane to live in denial of your own feelings? Because there is no point in Wallace's mind where he does not want to see her with her clothes off. Like, he's in love with her. There's no semblance of, like, trying to be friends. He's just put in a situation where he kind of has to pretend to want to be friends. So, like, I don't think there's almost a mixed message there. That's just, like, the complexities of, you know, people saying one thing when sometimes they mean another, which is unfortunately the case. But not unfortunately, because, like, he's not, again, there isn't anything malicious in it. He just knows that he can't have anything more at that point, but he's found someone who makes him really happy, so he doesn't want to give that up. But in order to not give it up, there is, like, an act of deceit.
If you were Wallace, would you have kissed Chantry sooner?
Yes, definitely.
Like, how far in?
Dressing room, like, no. No, I don't know how far in, but I know I wouldn't have just gone for it. I wouldn't have just unannounced, like, just kissed her, because that might have been a bit much. But I definitely would have had to have the conversation sooner. Like, I don't live in uncertainty as well as my character does, and yeah, I would have had to just, you know, even if you don't get the answer you want, then you can sort of move on with your life.
So it'd been a short film.
It would have been a really short film, but that's the thing, we wouldn't have been able to get a film out of it. It would have been terrible. I love Arthur, the original, with Dudley Moore and Liza Minnelli. You have to make that clear now. And what else? There's a great movie that, if you haven't seen, I would recommend it, called It Happened One Night, which is a 1937, maybe? Clark Gable, yeah, Frank Capra. I'd never seen it until we did this film, and it was recommended to me because we were doing this, and it's honestly one of the most charming romantic comedies I've ever seen. If you haven't seen it, you should check it out. What else? When Harry Met Sally is, like, up there, like, it's a fantastic film. I remember watching that and just being stunned by how funny and clever the dialogue was all at once without trying too hard to be either. So, yeah, I mean, those, and I'm sure I could think of more if I had more time. Oh, you know what's a really stupid one that somebody reminded me of, the fact that I love earlier today, this is like a film for my teenage years, is Get Over It, with Ben Foster and Martin Short. It's hilarious in that movie, and is also the reason I remembered, because I watched it again not long ago, and it is also the reason that I was in love with Kirsten Dunst for most of my teenage years. God, you know what, actually, can it be someone I've worked with? Okay, probably, I don't know if that makes it less interesting or not. I'd have to say Alex Adler, who directed Me and Horns. He's just the best director. He's an amazing director. Like, he's also super cool and French and like, cool and French. But he's a very, very nice, like, a complete leader of men on set, and just everyone loves him and wants to be a part of his vision. But he's just, like, got the most ridiculous facility for directing films, like, that I've ever seen. Like, the way he finds into every scene is original. Like, he just, I one day just hope to be a director half as good as he is, basically. I literally just left it. I finished doing a play like 3 weeks ago in New York. I did a play here last year. I'm trying as much as I can. I definitely want to. I definitely will do again, I hope. But I definitely haven't been making movies back to back because The Cripple of Inishman has accounted for about like 8 months out of the last 12 or so. So easily. Yeah, that'll be coming out next year. Oh no, he's got an English one. He sounds like a slightly rougher version of me, like just you know me, but just not quite as posh. But even though I don't think of myself as being massively posh, but I know I am a bit. prosthetics involved in that as well. Yes, quite a physicality. There's you know it is. I don't want to say too much because it give it away. But there's you get what you think of as Igor. I haven't yet. I'm going to. I've been asked about it a lot, which is sweet. Which is nice to be. You know, it's a very small club. The people who have had that sort of that weird pleasure, but it is a pleasure. And that's what's nice about all the stuff, all the press and the stuff I've seen from the guy in Boyhood is that it, you know, he's saying he had a great. It sounds like he had a really good time as well. It sounds like it was a really wonderful experience, as I'm sure it would be. I mean, I've met Richard Linklater once, and I'm sure that would be a great experience to work with him. I haven't seen it yet. I'm very excited to. It's going to be a weird one. Well, I suppose I could dress up to that as well. That's the thing. I mean, it's not really a frustration. Like, I'm very accepting of what my life is and what one of the limitations of my life is definitely that were I to walk on the Comic-Con floor without anything, there would be a reaction to it. Without anything, particularly then, yes. That's fine. It's not so much a frustration. It's just like nice to be able to do that kind of thing once in a while, and and have that interaction with people without it getting being a famous person sort of changing the way that people interact with you, because for better or worse, I'm not saying like because most people's reaction to meeting someone they know from the telly is to be very nice and very very friendly, but so I'm not saying that I don't like that reaction, but it's just nice to experience life without it, even if for like an hour, even if you are wearing a Spider-Man suit.
Could you see?
I could see, yeah. We actually had to... The mask that came on the suit was pretty terrible, so we had to tuck that back in, and I had to get another mask, which I could see out of. But thanks for asking. It's all in the detail.
Not canon, though.
Like all of them. I mean, I don't know. I feel bad saying this when I have... I should be promoting this film, so I should definitely say Wallace, but I'm going to say Ig from Horns, which comes out later in the year, just because it's, I think that's it. That's a crazy movie, and it one that could find a totally different kind of cult audience, and I'd be very happy with that, because that's just like, if I'm remembered for Harry and Ig, you can't really get two more disparate characters, so I'm happy with that.